Y'all still keep going on your break. My name is Megan Bomar, the Educational Coordinator for POSGCD Savannah, and I just wanted to give a little quick update. So for this summit, we have a hashtag that y'all be able to follow on social media or use in your post. So go ahead and use this hashtag if you're going on social media. We are on Facebook and Twitter, and you can find our handles right here. We're on Facebook, POSGCD Savannah GCD. And on Twitter, it's just POSGCD. So go ahead and get on there, follow us, like us, follow along with what we do. And it's a great way to stay up to date with what the district is doing. We give you updates on the services we offer, what kind of resources that we put up, as well as agendas, meetings, reminders, that sort of stuff, and conservation water tips throughout every week. And so, we also have a YouTube, which we put up videos there. We put those on our website as well, so you can find them by either going to YouTube and looking at POSGCD Savannah, or going to our website and looking up videos. So be sure to give us a follow and to also keep continue using the hashtag. So follow along and join the conversation. Thanks. Hi, everybody. Feel free to keep getting cookies and drinks and everything. I'm just going to kind of go over a few little things on the website, which I think are important to kind of be able to find just in case you're looking for some information. And first and foremost, you can find all the administration information right here on this tab. We have all of our information about our directors, our staff, and then if you keep going down, you can find all of the archived minutes from all of the past board and committee meetings. So you can find all the information down here. And also, talking about committees, if you go under the outreach tab, excuse me, the mouse is going crazy, go all the way down to the bottom, there's what is the board dashboard. And this is where you can find all the information about who, what, director is on what committee, what they're working on, and what that committee is supposed to do. And then if you go down a little bit further on that page, maybe, you can go down and find all of the committees down here on the bottom, and it goes through item by item, what they're working on, what schedule they're working on, and how they are getting to that deadline. And we try to keep this as up to date as possible. But if you ever have any questions, please feel free to call the office. We'll answer any questions that we're able to. In addition, there's some district information right here where you can find all of our management plans, our rules, anything that deals about the district. We also have a tab for resources. So we have grant programs that are available on certain bases. And then we'll be adding the rainwater harvesting grant program to the website eventually. And once that is up and running, we'll make sure to put that out on social media and other forms of media to let you know. We also have outreach where you can find education material. You can schedule presentations for any organizations that you're a part of. Town hall meetings. If you ever want the district to come and speak to your event, just give us a call. We are more than happy to come and speak anything. Pretty much, we've covered what the mission of the district is, as well as how offers work, and what are some water conservation tips. And then, in addition, we also have GMAs, and then information for well users, and applications, which Bobby knows a little bit more about. I don't know if you want to talk about that, or? So for applications, So, I've only been at the district for 3 months, so I'm not exactly sure how all of the applications work, but I'll let Bobby kind of take over this part.
So quickly, if you go into the applications, one of the biggest questions that we get, I'm Bobby, by the way, y'all haven't seen me around today. I know y'all seen me in the past, maybe, but I've been hiding up on top, kind of running the show from the background. But anyway, one of the biggest questions that we always get is what application do I need to fill out, or what application do I need if I want a domestic well or livestock well, or if I need a permitted well, I want to do irrigation, or I want to have a frack well or something like that. I don't know if there's too many oil and gas companies in here, but I'll answer those questions anyway. So really simply, we'll start, try to go quickly, but from top to bottom in order of importance, the very top one of the very first application that you're going to see on there is to record an exempt well. In our district, an exempt well, again, incapable of producing more than 25,000 gallons a day, used for domestic use, which means it's going into your household. You may be using it for watering your lawn or a couple of trees, maybe a small garden or something like that. Or it's being used for livestock production as well, coming out to a trough, into a tank or something like that. So anybody can record an exempt well. Drillers, on the weekend, if a driller needs to come in and work on your well because your well is no longer producing or something happened with it, the pump broke, something like that, the driller's first question to you is going to be, is your well registered with Post Oak Savannah Groundwater Conservation District? If you don't know the answer to that question, you can go online really quickly, fill out this one-page form. It's literally one page. Who are you? Where's the well located? And who's filling out the application? Give that to the driller. The driller will turn that in to us, or you can mail that in to us. We can register your well. The driller can then work on your well that same day. There's no need for them to wait around or come back a later time because you didn't know if your well was registered or the driller didn't know. Anybody can register that well for you. That way, we don't mean to be a hindrance to them working on your well or your well getting registered. You've already heard why it's important. First of all, it's required by law. State law requires that you register your well. Second of all, it protects your well from spacing. It protects your well from other wells that might be going in. And we get to help our permits or our larger permits that may be coming in. Oil and gas, I know the question was thrown around earlier. What about those oil and gas wells or the frack wells? We have to space them accordingly when their permits come in also to these wells. So that's where registering your well and knowing where that well is located comes in handy. So if you can always either throw a map with that, or if you have a way of getting latitude and longitude for us, that helps tremendously. So if you can always throw that information in your application, that's great. Second one, if you're drilling a new well, or if you're going to replace an old well and drill a new well, the second application on this form is on this page is the one that you're looking for. It's the application to drill and operate an exempt well. Again, that's because you're using it for domestic or you're using it for livestock, and you're going to be less than 18 gallons a minute. Typical wells are running about 10 to 15 gallons per minute. When you call the driller, they're going to drill you a 4-inch well that's going to telescope down to a 2-inch well. This is the application that you're looking for. Majority of the times, 90% of the people who call into our office, this is the form they're looking for. Probably the rest of y'all in here, maybe 90% of y'all in here as well, that's the form that you would probably be looking for. That's the one Gary said, you can bring it in. 20 minutes later, you're walking out the door with a certificate to proceed with drilling. The driller is then required. There's a form on the very bottom of this page. That's the driller's completion form. The driller is required to turn that in to us in order for you to get your $100 deposit back and in order for your well to become officially registered with the district. So you don't really get your registration right off the bat within 20 minutes. You get that certificate to proceed with drilling. When we get that information back, it says, yes, it has been drilled to state standards. And yes, that well is not producing more than 25,000 gallons a day. That's what that completion form is doing. It's the driller basically confirming or telling us, the district, that the pump that they put in that well is considered an exempt pump. It's not something that's going to be producing more than it needs to be and then requires an actual permit. So, and then on the chance that you are seeking a permit, that's a couple of terms that we always run into. So you have a registered well, which is just the exempt wells, and then you actually have a permitted well. So a permitted well is what we consider a non-exempt well. Those are the wells that are used for irrigation. Those are the wells that are used for frack water. Those are the wells that, if you do want to use it for domestic and livestock use, but you want to put in a little bit bigger than 18 gallons a minute, say you want to put in a 35-gallon a minute pump, or you have a chicken house and you're under contract with Sanderson Farms and they require you to have 35 or 50 gallons per minute, by contract, this is the application that y'all have to fill out, because our rules don't allow for more than 25,000 gallons per day, or on that exception. So that does require a permit. It is considered ag use, so you don't have to go through the hearing process. You are exempt from the hearing process, but you do have to go through the permit, other permit requirements. So those are, for the most part, the important ones. We do have some oil and gas applications. If you're doing a rig supply, because you need a drill in your oil and gas well, those rig supplies are considered exempt. Two-page application, easy to fill out. If you're going to be doing frac, that is that one-year application or that one-year permit that Gary was talking about earlier. It's a little bit more involved than the exempt rig supply well. But that form is there as well. And then if you can, Megan, scroll to the bottom. Somebody had a really good question. I believe it was the lady here in the front that asked about plugging wells. If you have an old well that's deteriorated or abandoned, Gary did mention recently we adopted some new rules within the district to change our grant program. So our grant program used to be we would pay 3/4 of the cost up to $1,000. A lot of the wells cost a lot more than $1,000 to plug. So by the time we even got our 3/4 of the share in, we were always paying up to $1,000, and that still left the owner on the hook for that remainder. Well, that service kind of a hindrance to people wanting to plug their wells, even though by law they need to be if they are deteriorated. They need to be, so because that it's a protection of water quality issue, the board decided let's up that cost a little bit. Let's help get these wells plugged. That way, cost is not the factor that's holding us back from getting that done. So we upped it. We're paying 100% of the costs now to plug wells. So if you have a well that you want to plug, give us a call or fill out this application. It's at the bottom. It's the application for district assistance to plugging a well. That's the form that you're looking for. Tell us why you want to have it plugged. Somebody, either me or Ralph, who we'll introduce in a little bit, will come out and we'll inspect that well really quickly. Just, you know, say where it's at. Make sure that the driller's going to be plugging the right well and not just some other random well on your property or the one that's actually working. And then we'll enter into a contract agreement with the driller, the landowner, and ourselves. Basically says that we'll pay out the 100% of that cost, up to $2,500. Now, in the instance that for some reason it does cost more than $2,500 to plug a well, we haven't seen one just yet unless you're plugging an oil and gas well, which then this doesn't apply. But if you are plugging, well, if it does cost more than $2,500, then the landowner is unfortunately on the hook for that small amount, usually small amount. $2,500 for the most part, like I said, has covered the majority of those costs. So, as far as applications, I think those are the ones that are the most important that y'all would be needing. I don't know, Gary, is Gary still here? No? Okay. All right, so I don't know if there's any others that you need, but I'll hand it back over to Megan real quickly, and she'll go over a couple more things on the website if she needs to.
I was just going to say, if you have any more questions about the website, just come find me and I'll help you walk through it. So I'll hand it back to you.